morning. Well, I will try in English this year. Dear students, dear parents, dear members of BFA, dear Mr. Dao, welcome back to Kandan after the holidays. It's almost like a small tradition for me that I can be present at your opening ceremony. Thank you for this great opportunity. I'm impressed by your diversity, and I am already looking forward to the performance. Thank you very much for this. I am pleased that we are starting the new year together and wish you a wonderful time in Kandan in a good and profitable community with many great experiences. May happiness and success accompany you in this school year. So let's begin. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning. And now for the best part, the roll call of nations. Here we go. Let's start with Afghanistan. Albania. Australia. Azerbaijan. Belgium. Bolivia. Brazil. Bulgaria. Cambodia. Canada. China. Czech Republic. Democratic Republic of Congo. Egypt. Finland. France. Georgia. Germany. Yeah. Ghana. Greece. Honduras. Hong Kong. Hungary. India. Iraq. Israel. Italy. Jordan. Kazakhstan. Kyrgyzstan. Latvia. Lesotho. Libya. Lithuania. Malawi. Malta. Mauritania. Monaco. Mongolia. Morocco. The Netherlands. Niger. Oman. Pakistan. Palestine. Papua New Guinea. Peru. The Philippines. Poland. Portugal. Qatar. Republic of Kosovo. Romania. Saudi Arabia. Sierra Leone. Singapore. Slovakia. South Korea. Spain. Switzerland. Tajikistan. Tunisia. Turkey. The United Kingdom. The United States of America.
Fellow students, teachers, parents, family, and family that are watching online. My name is Joy King, and I'm this year's student body president. And I'm very, 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 very honored to be speaking in front of you guys all. To all the new students in this room, you guys, we are so happy to see you guys here. And to all the returning students, it's so good to see you guys again. And to everyone, welcome. It's fascinating to me how we are, like, we live so different lives, but as of this morning, we're here together as one community. We come from so many different cultures and backgrounds, but today we're here to celebrate the same start. To begin, I am going to share a little bit about myself. I am Korean, born but not raised in Korea. I lived in Kyrgyzstan until I was about 2, and lived in Oman until I moved to BFA for high school. And those, for those of you who aren't really familiar with Oman, it's that country right next to Saudi Arabia and Dubai, and it's very hot. It's not Amman, that's like the city in Jordan, but it's like the country, Oman. So what I want to share with you guys today is how my transition to BFA was like. Every single one of us here is experiencing the first day of a new chapter. This doesn't apply to just the new students, but it applies to the middle schoolers coming into high school. It applies to all the students going into a higher grade. It applies to seniors, and it applies to every parent as well who are stepping into a new chapter of parenthood. And this change can be very scary. Yes, there are times where change is very fun and very exciting, but for me, I'm terrified of change. The summer I moved from Oman to Condren in 2020 in the midst of the pandemic, I was not that happy about this huge change in my life. Everything was going way faster than what my mind could handle, and I was just not happy about it. I remember my first day of BFA, I was a freshman. I was sitting right there with my freshman class, and I was listening to Sarah Ebenroth's opening ceremony speech. And I did not know what was happening. I was very overwhelmed. I was very scared. And everything and anything was intimidating. But as time went on, I understood the BFA culture. I understood the BFA people, just like you guys would too soon. So this was a good thing, right? To understand the culture, the people, just to fit in, to be changing. I didn't think so. I didn't like this change that was occurring in me. That December, so 4 months after I started attending BFA, I was calling my friend who was in Oman, and we were talking. And then suddenly he goes, "Joy, you've changed." And at that moment, I realized I didn't really like how that sounded. I didn't like hearing that I've changed. While I was glad that I was fitting into the school, making friends, and just like adapting into the community, I wasn't happy that I was becoming a new person. I didn't feel like I was ready to change. But it has been 3 years since then, and that freshman joy has become senior joy, and I have indeed changed. So if I could go back right now and tell anything to freshman joy, I would say, it'll be all right. Change is happening because it's supposed to be happening. Change is when something or someone evolves into a new or different state. And yes, change can surely happen with one strong desire and want. But I don't think that change can occur with only these elements. I believe that disregard to our motives and wants, change occurs through God's plan. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3:1, it says, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens." Just like how it may seem coincidental that we're all here on August 30th, around 9:20-ish, in a small German town, it's not coincidental at all. God had a plan for each and one of us to end up here no matter how much we did or did not want this to happen. What I want to say is that new students, especially those coming into freshman year, but not only you guys, everyone else too, please do not be afraid of what is to come. Have open hearts for change, but don't be discouraged when you don't feel the active change happening. That's the way God works through us. He changes us without us knowing, just like how I didn't know that I was changing my freshman year, and I didn't want that change, but God wanted that change, and he had a plan for me. That was my season of my transition, and you guys will all have your seasons of your transitions, and this will all be under God's knowledge. So this year, I want to challenge everyone to keep this in mind and take advantage of the change that God is going to do through you guys. If God has things planned differently than you guys have, it's going to happen anyways, so might as well take the advantage of it. So I challenge us to not be afraid of change, because we know that no matter how much we change, God will be the same yesterday, today, and forever. So to end it, I would like to continue the tradition that has been going on. I mean, the past seniors have done it, so I want to continue it. It's like they give a quote of a philosopher or a famous person. And I think this quote reiterates my point of saying that we don't know how God's going to change us, but that's the beauty of it all. The quote goes, "You don't know you're beautiful, but that's what makes you beautiful." One Direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Joy. We are looking forward to the transformation that is going to happen in our students this year. And now I have the privilege of giving the charge to our senior class. So, class of 2024, would you please stand to receive your charge? The grade 12 class of Black Forest Academy. God has brought you into this learning community to grow spiritually, mentally, physically, and socially. Out of love and respect for you as student leaders, we ask and expect that you offer your best efforts in your learning, your attention to instruction, your pursuit of excellence, and your desire to achieve God's best for you. That you offer your classmates a model that is worthy of following in your attitude towards those in authority. That you offer proper respect to your fellow students who, like you, bear the image of God. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." Thank you.
I want to start off by thanking Joy again for that incredible address to us. Joy, thank you. The mission of Black Forest Academy is to provide a quality international Christian education that equips its students to influence their world through biblical thought, character, and action. Every word of that mission statement was chosen carefully and matters, but this morning I'm going to focus on just one word, and that is the word influence. Allow me, if you will, to take a short trip down memory lane. It was late in August of 1985. I was 15 and a new boarding student at a school in Kenya very much like Black Forest Academy. I don't think I would have described myself as anxious, but I was certainly a complicated bundle of nerves and excitement. As I looked around my students, my fellow students in that auditorium back in 1985, I don't think any of us had any idea of what was coming next. And Joy, your reference to change is significant. I could not have anticipated the life-changing experiences that I would go on to share with many in that school auditorium, or the depths of friendships that would develop. And I certainly would have never predicted the levels of influence that my peers in that room would go on to have through their lives. But in fairness, I think I can be forgiven for not having seen that potential. As I look back on that time and look around that room in my mind, there were few obvious clues of influence in the auditorium that day. We looked and acted like most typical high school students because that's what we were. We were typical high school students. I suppose our TCK upbringing did set us apart from the typical high school student in our home countries. But while there were gifts and talents that were hiding underneath the surface in that room, few of us could have been described, or few of us would have described ourselves as extraordinary. I don't think there were any perfect SAT scores in the room that day, and I don't think that there were any future Division I athletic scholarship recipients. And yet, from among that very normal group of people, many would go on to have a significant influence on their world. I think of Rick Bransford, one of the home students in my class, the son of the doctor at the local mission hospital. While it is true that Rick was more disciplined and driven than many of us, and that's not saying a lot, perhaps, his teachers probably would have expected him to do something positive with his life, but I don't think anyone in that room would have expected that he would have gone on to become one of the world's renowned spine surgeons. I think of Kyle Kirkpatrick, the son of Baptist missionaries in Kenya, who would go on to a lifetime of missions leadership in the Balkans, and whose three children graduated from BFA, which is his highest, his greatest accomplishment. I think of Brian McKenzie, the very unassuming and under-the-radar MK from Madagascar, who would rise to become the European vice president for a multi-billion dollar company called Alcoa before helping to launch and lead a faith-driven company called Kintegra in Kenya that is responsible for literally helping hundreds of thousands of Kenyans pull themselves up out of poverty. But I also think of Terry Toso. He would not go on to become a renowned doctor or a leader in missions or a CEO of a flourishing multinational. Terry can best be described as a local handyman in a small and largely forgotten town in rural Northern Ireland. Terry's influence may not be externally impressive, and few outside of his community would know who he and his family were. But inside that town in rural Northern Ireland, Terry and his family, through their sacrificial love and compassion and kindness, have profoundly changed that culture and that community. There's a story that his wife tells of her coming home one afternoon and Terry carrying down their mattress from their bedroom upstairs, and she looked at him and said, "What's going on?" "Well, there's a family that has just moved into town, a refugee family, and they don't have a bed, so I'm giving them ours." That's the spirit that Terry has adopted in his life, and that is the Christ-like attitude that he has adopted that has changed his community. On the scales of worldly success, Terry ranks low. But I can't wait to see the celebration of Terry's influential life in heaven. Many of the same things that I've said about my peers in that room that day in 1985 could be said about you. Your names, your last names are not Rockefeller or Gates or Kennedy, and you may not feel particularly extraordinary. But if you're willing, God can do and will do incredible things through your life in the years ahead. I know this because the history of BFA and the lives of our alumni show that to be true. But I'm also aware that the world that you're preparing to influence is very different from the one that I and my classmates entered back in 1985. In some ways, it is a lot more challenging. Your world feels less like 1985 and much more like the world of Daniel in Scripture. If our mission is to inspire and equip you for Christ-honoring influence, it seems relevant to look at the life of Daniel. This morning, I would like us to consider the following question. What allowed Daniel and his peers to be influential within a largely hostile culture? The book of Daniel points to four C's of Christ-honoring influence in an increasingly hostile world. The first C is courage. By way of context, it is the 7th century BC, which you're all very familiar with. And Daniel and his world are being turned upside down. Jerusalem, the city of David, the symbol of God's chosen people, had fallen. Perhaps even more significantly, the temple, the symbol of God's presence with his people, had been ransacked and desecrated. From this trauma, Daniel and his fellow TCKs were separated from all that they knew and loved and taken over 1,000 miles away to Babylon to be trained to serve a hostile empire. If there was a group that was vulnerable to compromise and indoctrination, it was Daniel and his Jewish peers. They were young, no more than 17, discouraged, alone, rootless in a culture that was actively hostile to everything that they held dear. In addition, they were given powerful incentives, both sticks and carrots, to replace their God-centered identity with the values and beliefs of their new culture. Even before they experienced it themselves, Daniel and the others had seen firsthand the incredible cruelty of Babylon towards those who defied it. Gruesome public executions were common. But while Babylon was unspeakably cruel to those who rebelled, it was also a place of wealth and comfort and beauty for those who embraced it. Its palaces and temples were considered among the greatest architectural wonders of that day. And for the elite in the empire, their experience far surpassed anything that Daniel would have experienced in Jerusalem. So if a cruel death awaited those who did not fully embrace Babylon, wealth, luxurious comforts, fame, and power awaited those who did. Under these circumstances, discouraged, cut off almost entirely from the roots, fearing for their lives, and simultaneously being tempted with wealth and comfort, what would you have done? When many of us think about Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, courage is the first thing that comes to mind. We think of the stories from Sunday school where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refuse to bow to the idols that the king had set up and are thrown into the fiery furnace. And we think of God's protection of Daniel in the lion's den. But Daniel's first test of courage was much more subtle and came soon after they arrived in Babylon. He was simply asked to tweak his diet. Here is the description of what we find in Daniel 1, starting in verse 3. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. They were to be trained for 3 years, and after that they were to enter the king's service. Verse 8 goes on to say, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with royal food and wine. Daniel's decision was not simply challenging the taste of the royal chef, he was challenging the king. And over what? A tweak to his diet? Under these life-threatening circumstances, certainly a little compromise was in order. But for Daniel to break God's dietary law was to publicly dishonor God. And so this is where Daniel determined he needed to draw his line in the sand. In a quiet but unmistakable way, this was Daniel's Martin Luther, here I stand moment. It seems significant that despite the fact that there was a number of Jews under similar circumstances, it appears only a few made the choice that Daniel made. In verse 8 of chapter 1, the text doesn't read, but the Jews resolved not to defile themselves. Instead, it singles out only Daniel, and then later adds Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego as those few that were willing to risk death rather than to compromise their commitment to God. There is a boldness and inspirational freedom that we see in them that can only come when you've declared your non-negotiables and have counted the costs. One famous military leader once said, "To win any battle, you must fight like one who is already dead." And throughout the rest of the book of Daniel, we see the power and freedom that comes from having counted the costs. In fact, that apparently small act of courage by Daniel became the foundation upon which everything else in the book of Daniel rests. Without the courage of their convictions in this apparently small item, Daniel and the others would have never had anything like the level of God-honoring influence that they ended up having in Babylon. But we also know that while courage is universally admired, it doesn't necessarily lead to influence. Daniel and the others became influential because their courage was complemented by competence or excellence. They earned the respect of those in authority by doing all that they could do, all that they did with excellence. In a hostile culture, influence only comes when it is earned. This is seen throughout the book, but again, we see Daniel's commitment to excellence almost immediately in chapter 1. When Daniel and his peers are brought before King Nebuchadnezzar after finishing their 3 years of training, we read this. The king talked with them, and he found none equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they enter the king's service. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. It is clear here and elsewhere that Daniel's influence would not have happened without his competence. He did things well, and he earned the respect of those in authority. But most surprising to me is the clear evidence throughout the book of Daniel that his influence resulted from the trust the authorities had placed in him because he was a good citizen. Throughout the book, we see he and his friends consistently seeking the flourishing of the king and Babylon. Considering the context, I find this shocking. Babylon, after all, was responsible for the destruction of Jerusalem and Daniel's exile. But the call to citizenship is consistent with God's command to his people through the prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah 29:7, where God says, "Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper." There are multiple examples of this, but again, we see an authentic commitment to being a good citizen from the very start. When Daniel saw that the food being assigned to him was contrary to God's law, he didn't make a public show or look for a dramatic confrontation. He quietly went to his supervisor and sought a way to honor God and live with integrity without bringing dishonor to the king. Later in chapter 4, when Daniel is asked to interpret a dream, it is clear that he is genuinely grieved by the hard news that he's going to share with the king. To the extent that it's the king that needs to reassure Daniel, "Do not let the dream or its meaning alarm you." To which Daniel earnestly replies, "My lord, if only the dream applied to your enemies and the meaning to your adversaries." Yet in keeping with his convictions, Daniel then goes on to courageously speak truth to the most powerful person in the world. And remarkably, the king is willing to listen to a bold attack on his rule and a prophetic call to repentance. And it's because Daniel had earned his respect and affection by honoring the king's authority and by working for the good of Babylon wherever he could. In this incredible exchange, we see that Daniel's genuine commitment to serve the king wherever he could had produced in the king a deep reservoir of trust in Daniel, and that led to unparalleled influence. In this last story, and in most of the other significant stories in the book of Daniel, we see the coming together of the three C's of God-honoring influence: the admiration resulting from the courage of Daniel's conviction, the respect resulting from his competence, and the trust resulting from his good citizenship. But there is still something more important underneath the courage, competence, and citizenship of Daniel. Nothing in this story of influence happens without Daniel making the choice to put God first and to surrender his will to God's. It is that choice that is the source of Daniel's courage and the inspiration behind his competence and citizenship. And it is that choice that shaped and colored every part of Daniel's life and ultimately produced the God-honoring influence that we find in Daniel. Our hope and prayer is that this year will be absolutely packed with fun experiences, deep and lasting relationships, and rich learning for you. That through the ups and downs, you will make life-giving memories that inspire and encourage you in the years ahead. But we also hope that this year will be an important step in equipping you for a life of God-honoring influence, a life that is characterized by the courage, competence, and citizenship we find in Daniel, and that is built upon the foundation of a choice that you must make for yourselves, to honor God with your lives. I'd like to welcome the worship team to come and join us, or to come and lead us in this.
Would you please stand with us?
We were waiting without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
You guys can have a seat.
Good morning. I want to thank the worship team for leading us in that song, but also Dr. Dell and for Joy for their words of encouragement. Joy, you talked about community and change, and this is an amazing place of community. Every year it changes, and yet there's something that's the same that is so significant because you guys know that a lot in your life has changed. But you could come back here. This is my 13th opening ceremony, flag ceremony. I don't think I've made it through a single one without crying, and I just keep thinking, at some point, right, this is gonna stop feeling so significant, but I hope not. And I hope that one day you can come back and see it too, through your adult eyes. Eyes that are so glad that you changed the way that you did, and that the change that started here will just continue. Dr. Dow's comments on influence are also significant. This world is different. It's different from the one I grew up in, but it is a world where you guys will stand out in the most amazing of ways. God's people are the light, and you literally walk around with the answer to people's struggles and problems. You carry it in your hearts, and you live it out through your actions and your words. Be courageous. Choose excellence. Desire peace and prosperity in the places that God will call you from here. Choose those things today that you can make a difference. Be free in Christ. Will you pray with me? Father, it is such a gift and such a joy to be a part of this community. Father, we thank you for all the adults that have been called to Condern, called here to teach, called here to live, called here to be parents, called here to volunteer. Lord, would you bless those people? Would you call them to the students that are in front of them? Call them to pray for them. Call them to coach and to spend time with them, to mentor and to be small group leaders, to lead them all over this earth when we do service projects. God, thank you for the opportunities of ministry, but also of just life on life here that you give us. And Lord, I pray for the parents in this room that don't live here, but go all over the world carrying your word and your message, those that you've called to be away from this place. God, we pray for them as they say their goodbyes and give their hugs. We pray for them as they have travel coming up. We pray for success in the places where you've called them. Would they bring your peace and your prosperity to those places in the world? And Father, I pray for the students right in front of me. I thank you for the students that you've called here for the school year of 2023 and 2024. What a gift that we'll get to be together. Father, that you'll be teaching us this year how to rest in you, how to trust you. Father, would our hearts choose to follow after you, even if we're resistant, even if we don't want to change, because that's so valid. It's so valid to feel afraid, and it's so valid that we could hear those lies that say, stay where you are, stay safe. But God, we know that's not what's going to keep us safe. Drawing close to you is really the only way that we can stay safe. So would you give us the courage to choose that?
because it's that first step that can be so hard. Would you allow us, Lord, to trust in you and to trust where you're taking us and to trust that you've brought us right here? Would you give us hearts and eyes for one another so that people wouldn't feel alone in this place of community? Would you allow us to know you better? Receive the benediction from Ephesians 3. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.
Thanks again to all of you for joining us for our opening ceremony. Students, it's really good to see you all from up here at this angle. And I just have a few announcements now as we end our time. Middle school students, you get to leave this room first. You're going to go with your principal, Mr. Koyman, out this door over here. And actually, we'll just go ahead and do that right now. So everyone else can cheer the middle schoolers over. Okay, as they're heading out, let me explain what's going to happen next. So we have high school students and parents and staff left in this room. What's going to happen next is we're going to ask the parents and high school students who live in dorms or parents who otherwise are having to leave the community today, this week, to make your way out next. We're not going to do it quite yet, but if you're a home student, if your parents live here with you, and parents whose kids live here with you, you can kind of sit tight for a minute. We're going to ask those parents and students who need to say farewells to each other to leave next, and we'll ask you to go out back onto the patio area there, and you're going to have a little over half an hour by the time you get out there together. Those who do not need to say goodbye to their parents, you are going to have about a half hour to catch up with each other. You can stay right here in this room. You can go out and use the restrooms. You can be in the cafeteria area. But it's your chance to just reconnect and be happy to see each other and all those things that you want to do. All high school students, listen up. You need to be back in here by 10:30 sharp. And when you come in here, you need to have your schedule with you, which you are going to pick up from out in the cafeteria, or out. There will be tables out there where you're picking up your schedule on your way in. So you can stay in here, but you'll need to at least walk out there to get your schedule and come back at 10:30. Staff, if some of you are willing to help me break down the chairs in the cafeteria area to make room for the rest of our school day, that would be great. And otherwise, thank you again so much, Frau Penner, for being here with us. Thank you to all of our other parents and guests for your support, for all that you are going to continue to do going forward to make this school year successful and something that we pray brings glory to God. So thank you very much, and you are dismissed. So again, dorm students.